Good evening. Welcome to the third public event of the Gender Research Institute's series of public talks, Just Words, Free Speech, and Social Change. My name is Rashana Johnson. I'm Assistant Professor of History here at Dartmouth, and I am also a 2015 GRID Fellow. And this evening, I am honored to share a few brief remarks about GRID, and then I will introduce our speaker, Dr. Brittney Cooper. GRID brings together an interdisciplinary group of Dartmouth students, faculty, and staff who are interested in gender-related scholarship and social justice work. Our projects are motivated by the conviction that good scholarship facilitates better action and therefore strengthens our communities and our public arena and our democracy. Our goal is to translate these principles into our teaching, research, and civil society under the inspiration of our distinguished guests. GRID is involved in internships, scholarly support, student international research groups, but the main activity is the spring seminar. Professor Susan Bryson, postdoctoral fellow Breanne Gallagher, and the members of the GRID steering committee have been working since last spring to coordinate this year's seminar and lecture series. And that brings us to this evening's speaker. I will begin with my two favorite facts about her, and then I will get a little bit more official. First, she is from Louisiana, and she is also a Howard alum. And that's all we need to say, really. Dr. Brittney Cooper is Assistant Professor of Women's and Gender Studies and Africana Studies at Rutgers University. She earned a PhD in American Studies at Emory University. Dr. Cooper is a scholar of black women's intellectual history, black feminist thought, and race and gender in popular culture. Dr. Cooper is co-founder, along with Dr. Susanna Morris, of the Kronk Feminist Collective, a feminist of color scholar activist group that runs a highly successful blog. She is a regular contributor at Salon.com, and her cultural commentary has appeared at Ebony.com, TheRoot.com, The Los Angeles Times, The New York Times, TV Guide, Huffington Post Live, Color Lines, NPR, and Al Jazeera America. Somewhere in the middle of all of that, she has managed to produce her first book, Race, Women, Gender, and the Making of a Black Public Intellectual Tradition, which is currently under review with a major university press. Please join me in welcoming Professor Cooper. And really quickly, she will speak for about 40 to 45 minutes. We will take a short break, and then we will have about a half an hour for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Thanks so much to GRID for inviting me. I'm excited to be here. Thank you, Susan. Thank you, Nancy, for taking good care of me. Thank you, Rashana, my HU fam, for the wonderful introduction. I love meeting Howard people because we're great. and so, again, it's my pleasure to be here. So tonight, I want to talk for a few minutes about some work that I've been doing on futures of black feminism and black feminist theory. This curious thing happens whenever folks ask me what I do when they don't have access to the long bio. Usually I just say, I'm a black feminist theorist. And folks always look at me kind of sideways like, well, what's that? Or, you know, or a theorist of what, right? Which is interesting because I don't feel like when my white feminist colleagues say I'm a feminist theorist that they get the same question mark. Like, they might have to clarify the specifics, but feminist theorist names a universe of possibility for white women that when I say I'm a black feminist theorist, folks just kind of look at me like, we don't know what you're talking about. And it makes me mad, and so usually I just look at them and they look at me and there we stand. Part of the work now is about reinvigorating the project of black feminist theory and making a set of claims about what it means to do black feminist theoretical work. And so part of that work today I want to share with you is under this title, The Limits of Critique, Language Policing, and Social Media. So One of the things I've really been thinking about is how we reinvigorate the project of Black feminist theorizing in the academy, and also how we maintain the intellectual integrity of the Black feminist project as it moves through the interwebs where it has taken on a whole other vibrant and exciting life. And so I am a Black feminist in both these spaces, right, as an academic Black feminist and then also an like internet feminist, I guess that's what they call us now, sort of derisively sometimes, which I do not appreciate. So I want to talk about what it means to be a Black feminist in both those worlds. But I want to talk about the limits of critique within Black feminism more generally, and then near the end of the talk, I want to talk about what that looks like with the particular example of language policing and social media as a case. So let me begin with two broad and fairly contentious claims. The first is that the project of Black feminist theorizing has stagnated in the last two decades, due to a combination of theoretical neglect among Black feminists and a kind of colonizing project in the broader environs of white feminism that has sought to both mine and minimize the salience of Black feminism's most important theoretical contributions. The second proposition is related to the first, and it is that Black feminism's ethical commitment to world making has been outpaced by an ethical focus on inclusionary language and discourse. And this has placed us in a reactionary and co-optable position both in the academy and outside of it. And so I'm going to make those claims and then just argue that we need to have a realigning of priorities. So let me begin with the first claim. By returning to an earlier moment in Black feminist academic history that I think is relevant for assessing how Black feminism came to have the particular relationship to matters of discourse, language, and speech that it currently has. In the spring of 1987, Black feminist literary critic Barbara Christian published a now classic essay called The Race for Theory. She conceived of the piece as an occasion, as quote, an occasion to break the silence among those of us critics, as we are now called, who have been intimidated and devalued by the race for theory. She lamented the increasing popularity of a certain brand of literary criticism rooted in Western philosophy, whose currency was contained in notions of abstraction, inaccessible language, and supposed notions of universality that were really quite particular. She argued in the wake of this academic shift that, quote, people of color have always theorized, but in forms quite different from the Western form of abstract logic. Our theorizing, she wrote, is often in narrative forms, in the stories we create, in riddles and proverbs, in the play with language, since dynamic rather than fixed ideas seem more to our liking. Moreover, she argued that Black women's theorizing was preoccupied with a specific question, and that question was, how else have we managed to survive with such spiritedness the assault on our bodies, social institutions, countries, and our very humanity? And she affirmed that, quote, the women she grew up around continuously speculated about the nature of life through pithy language that unmasked the power relations of their world. The displacement and devaluing of Black women's theorizing constituted a brand of what Christian called academic hegemony. Her ambivalence about the role of theory was not hers alone, but was also expressed by other Black women academics at the time. And echoing this growing anxiety, Christian wrote, because I went to a Catholic mission school in the West Indies, I must confess that I cannot hear the word canon without smelling incense, that the word text immediately brings back agonizing memories of biblical exegesis, that discourse reeks for me of metaphysics forced down my throat in those courses that traced world philosophy from Aristotle through Thomas Aquinas to Heidegger. As I lived among folk for whom language was an absolutely necessary way of validating our existence, I was told that the minds of the world lived only on a small continent of Europe. The metaphysical language of the new philosophy, then, I must admit, is repulsive to me and is one reason why I race from philosophy to literature, since the latter seemed to me to have the possibilities of rendering the world as large and as complicated as I experienced it, as sensual as I knew it was. A native of the U.S. Virgin Islands, Christian's critique of new philosophy is at odds with her educational experiences in the West Indies, pointed to the ways that the advent of theory, capital T, in the academy was rooted in European and American forms of imperialist knowledge production. So more recently, in Alexander Wahaly's new book, Habeas Viscus, he argues that we have lost sight of the ways that there was a deracination of post neo-structuralism. Once it was annexed by the U.S. Academy in the 1970s, annexed from Europe and then rechristened as theory. So in responding to Christian, black feminist philosopher Donna Dale Marcano affirms that despite the fact that she and others like Christy Dotson, who I know came to visit you recently and who is a good friend of mine, and V. Denise James, are now three decades later making space for black women in the realm of academic philosophy, Christian's work importantly elucidates, quote, the way theoretical frameworks have often worked against black women in both feminist and black literature. Black women become forced to participate in a discourse, but always only to the extent that they exercise language and expression of often alien theoretical frameworks. So when Christian's talking about this in 1987, she's pointing to a real dilemma when she describes her aversion to the metaphysics of what she calls the new philosophy. She rejects a white male-centered Western philosophical account of the metaphysical world, which means she rejects the things that white men automatically take to be real. To articulate it the way that Ntozake Shange did in the book For Colored Girls, who have considered suicide when the rainbow is enough, a classic black feminist text, she said, being alive and being a woman and being colored is a metaphysical dilemma I haven't conquered yet. In saying that discourse, which is a term we use a lot, right, in post-structuralist conversations. So in saying that discourse reeked of a metaphysics forced down her throat, Christian constructs the post-structuralist turn, and she's writing this at the heart of the height of the post-structuralist turn in the academy, and black feminism negotiating what its relationship to the post-structuralist turn will be, which is why I'm focused on this particular moment. So Christian constructs the post-structuralist turn to discourse as a bodily assault that curtails various black female and black feminist modes of articulation. So she says the turn to discourse actually is forced down her throat, which prohibits her from being able to say particular kinds of things that she wants to say. So Donna Dale Marcano gets at one of the key metaphysical challenges black feminists face within post-structuralism by considering how the social construction thesis acts differentially upon categories of race and gender. We know the social construction thesis that, you know, race and gender are not biologically rooted but are social constructs, right? Well, but that turns out differently depending on how you apply them. So unlike in the case of gender, wherein the social construction thesis posits a notion and produces a notion of complexity because it disrupts the false unity of categories like woman or sex or gender. In the case of race, post-structuralism would have us to conclude, or the social construction thesis would have us to conclude, that we are not with a description of a complex reality, but rather it leaves us with an insistence on non-reality. So this is the thing where people want to put race in scare quotes, right? Like it doesn't exist. Some of these are old debates, but part of what I'm saying is that they matter for this particular moment because they tell us something about our continuing challenges with the relationship to discourse. That is why I'm, and for some of the scholars in the room, rehearsing what feel like old arguments. So what Marcano says is that ambiguities, revelations of exclusions, and the disruption of race have led to the non-reality of race, where ambiguity of sex or gender leads to a complex reality that must be confronted, right? So that then you come to this post-structuralist conclusion that race does not exist, which means one is left merely to do battles within the metaphysical realm over exactly what reality or battles there are. So in other words, the social construction thesis and post-structuralism have given us a language to make complex conversations about gender and race, right? Right? But what we have concluded then is that race really doesn't exist, and so folks are always rushing to this sort of post-racial reality. And while we scoff at people who do that, because we recognize the ways in which that is problematic, we have to realize that liberal academic discourse set us on the path to folks drawing those kinds of conclusions that we could actually become post-racial, right? Meanwhile, we don't seem to be invested in the notion that because gender is a social construct, because it is performative, because it is complex, that it doesn't exist. But somehow we take the same theory, and with race, you get non-reality, right? So many scholars over the years have called out the problems of putting race in scare quotes and acting as though a lack of biological basis means that the ideology of race and racism doesn't have real material effects. But what Marcano's observation asks us to think about is not just this as a political question, but as a theoretical question about what metaphysical account of reality we accept. So what, for instance, is the relationship of feeling or sensory perception and affect to a philosophical account of reality? Because Christians' discourse or discussion invokes sensory language, smells, brings back memory, she says, reeks, in regard to philosophy, and so it invites us to ask about the place of affect in a new generation of Black feminist theorizing, and it also asks us to think about how feeling and sensory perception return us back to the Black female body, negotiating Black feminism on post-structuralist terms and feeling suffocated. So part of what I am arguing is that there's a moment in the 80s when Black feminism makes a choice to get into bed with post-structuralism because it needs to claim academic and institutional legitimacy. That is the thing that Christian is writing against, right? The problem then is that if you think about how post-structuralism invites us to see everything as a social construct, then Black women are in a precarious position because literally how do we articulate the terms of our existence if race is an untenable category because it doesn't really exist even though its effects exist, and gender is so complex that you can't pin it down. But you have Black women still rooted in Black female bodies that are acted on structurally in very material, fairly consistent ways, right? So you have this tension between how we're supposed to talk theoretically about the problem of Black feminism that doesn't quite capture the complexities and problems of Black female existence, right? So then how do we clear our throats of a metaphysics that is alien to how the vast majority of Black women in the global North and South are structurally positioned regardless of their relative degrees of jeopardy within those structures? Because that is a problem of articulation, and so that's a problem of language, right? That if we're working with a metaphysics, an account of reality that has been forced down our throats, then we're working with frameworks that obstruct our ability to fully articulate the things that should matter within theoretical frameworks that are supposed to be about naming our own condition. How does this kind of deconstruct, So how do we more specifically reckon with the problem of the Black female body within post-structuralism, given that bodies are largely viewed as discourses to be deconstructed? How does this kind of deconstructive proposition work for a body that already occupies an untenable position in the history of Western thought? So, one of the places that this body problem continues to show up is in current feminist debates over the continued utility of the term intersectionality. So y'all know that there's this new move now to be post-intersectional within feminism, right? So Robin Wegman argues in her book, I think the book is 2011 from Duke Press, Object Lessons, that quote, intersectionality has reached the status of what she calls citational ubiquity, right? Because everyone claims to be doing some version of race, class, gender, and sexuality in their feminist work. That's all you ever hear. Race, you know, race, class, gender, or folks are naming their race, class, and gender. So the copious incorporation of intersectional perspectives into a range of feminist inquiry would seem to suggest that non-Black feminists have heard Black feminism's critiques and are responding to those critiques by being more inclusive, which supposedly is a thing we should celebrate. But Mimi Nguyen argues that, quote, the affirmative incorporation of women of color feminisms as a necessary intervention might also be a problematic teleology for feminist futures. In other words, that might not be the way to go. She continues, quote, interventions, and it's that language of interventions that she takes issue with. She says, interventions are best staged before it is too late and someone is lost beyond rehabilitation. Interventions then must be opportune, timed to occur within a brief window during which an intervention is efficacious and beneficial. Interventions are thus both eruptions of a progressive time and also course corrections that incorporated allow for a return to it. So in contemporary feminist theory, intersectionality is being framed as an important intervention, right, brought to bear primarily by Black women doing work in feminism. But because acts of intervention are considered not progressive, but rather eruptions of progressive time, i.e., we're trying to move forward, we have come to an obstacle, this obstacle is preventing us from moving forward, so what do we do with the obstacle, right? So interventions are considered an eruption of progressive time rather than being a marker of progressive time, and it has thus become easy to construct intersectionality within the analytic bounds of the intervention. Thus, some scholars as I'll demonstrate below, treat the ethical charge of intersectionality as a fait accompli as they hurriedly move along to cover new terrain. Meanwhile, there's a lot of hand-wringing about the ways in which Black women's lives and subjectivities have rendered them what Wigman terms the quote-unquote paradigmatic intersectional subject. This means that if intersectionality has been duly incorporated into feminism, rather than being a feminist narrative on its own terms, then Black women as primary intersectional subjects, or so this narrative goes, are also now constructed as being an eruption of progressive time, right? So Black women and Black feminism is intervention now. It is merely intersectional intervention. So it is the obstacle that is keeping feminist progress from moving forward, right? So it is constructed as what I call a site of feminism interruptus, which is a play on quidus interruptus, wherein non-Black feminism and feminists literally say to Black women, we, meaning not you, will let you interrupt us, right? Because they're being progressive. They're trying to hear our problem, right? They're trying to hear our outrage and respond. Rather than being considered temporally progressive, a Black feminism whose sole goal is to intervene constitutes a temporal marker of when it is time to move on from the study of Black women. So we have to resist this framing of intersection. So part of what I'm saying is Black feminism in this moment has largely been reduced. Like, when people think about the contributions of Black feminism to feminism, they say that our primary contribution is the term intersectionality. Really, think about it. What else do people say that we said? They say we said race and gender matter. That's it. So we have to resist that kind of framing because it leaves Black feminism in its own suspended state of interruptus, wherein our sole contribution to feminist discourse is reduced to the theorization of intersectionality. And in that framing, intersectionality becomes a kind of intellectual consciousness-raising session wherein white women learn that all the women weren't white. And having acknowledged that in some form or fashion, however insufficient, white women then can say Black feminism is now considered a thing to be moved on from and a set of intellectual propositions that are situated in the past rather than the future of feminist theory. This is then framed as though there are, Black feminism is then framed as though there are no new questions to be asked, leaving us in a suspended state of animation. They are always as a reference of where the field has been, receding into the past and assumed to have no relevance to where we should go. So the current debates over the continued relevance of the intersectional framework illumine many of these dynamics, demonstrating both the precarity of Black feminisms in the academy and the temporal logics of feminist theory that aim to colonize, circumscribe, and discard Black feminism as a retrograde theoretical project. So let me give you just a bit from Wigman and how she writes about this. She says, intersectionality pursues not only complexity, but particularity, specifically through the critical location attributed to both Black women and Black feminism, and in such a way that no configuration of identity as a constructed social relationship of power and subordination is thought to be beyond its analytic reach. So that the quote, particularity of Black women's identity position functions as the formative ground for a critical practice aimed at infinite conclusion calls forth a lot of hand-wringing from Wigman. She rhetorically poses an answer in the form of a question to her own anxieties about whether Black women's lives can be the basis for an inclusionary politic within Black feminism. She says, how can particularity retain the specificity it invokes when the destination it inscribes is to render critical practice not simply coherent but comprehensive in its analytic capacity and scope? So Wigman suggests that her questions name, quote, the tension between intersectionality as a commitment to the particularity of Black women's minoritization and its redeployment as the means to claim paradigmatic mastery over both the experiences of women of color and identity's historical, social, political, and psychic complexity as a whole. Pay attention to those two terms, mastery and identity. So here Wigman poses a false question, propped up by a false assumption. For her, her question assumes that all work that has already been ascribed to the status of the theoretical is not always already deeply particular. But what feminist theory as undertaken by white women has done is to expose the particularity of white male Western accounts of knowledge and experience, otherwise known as philosophy. Yet Wigman charges particularity is a kind of indictment of the theoretical reach of intersectionality and therefore black women. Her cautions about intersectional scope creep pivot on the claim that intersectionality seeks mastery over the account of experience of all women of color and of the theoretical account of identity for everybody. That kind of rhetoric is shot through with a kind of colonizing imperial logic that it is simply unfair to ascribe to the intellectual products of black feminism, particularly since black feminism's broader resistance to feminism proper, white feminism, mainstream feminism, is all about a resistance to being quote unquote mastered by a set of frameworks that are not imagined with black female bodies or cis and trans black women's lives anywhere in their purview. Moreover, it's a gross misreading of Kimberly Crenshaw. Crenshaw made clear that in naming intersectionality, she was not offering, quote, some new totalizing theory of identity. She was instead offering an account of structural power and at most structural identities, which are not simply the only kind of identities we can have. So such rhetoric from Wigman and others obscures the ways that white feminists in both Europe and the US have colonized intersectionality, treating black women, as Barbara Tomlinson argues in the case of European feminists, as, quote, a site to colonize and control. For instance, white feminist theorists now refer to intersectionality as a contribution from women's studies. Women's studies writ large, rather than from black feminism proper. This kind of move rehearses at least some of the logics of settler colonialism by reframing women's studies and feminism as the place where intersectionality began, when in fact intersectionality was conceived in a location adjacent in many respects to white feminism and white women's studies. So drawing from work among indigenous scholars theorizing settler colonialist logics, Christy Dotson argues that feminist practice in the US is shot through with, quote, doctrines of discovery that operate in, quote, epic feats of forgetting and a merciless logic of elimination. So to accuse black feminist paradigms of attempting to master everyone else's experience rather than attempting to make visible and name our own is just such an egregious act of forgetting that will be used in an academic institutional logic of elimination of the continuing legitimacy of black feminism. So when black women's theoretical contributions achieve institutional legitimacy, which is the one thing intersectionality has done for us, then even if that legitimacy is about exposing institutional logics of violence and power, suddenly, in this new rendering of history, black women, the quote-unquote intersectional paradigm, now become the masters. Or we are accused of doing violence to other women of color because intersectionality does not fully account for their experience. And so then black feminism is then reframed as a hegemonic project. Not only are such moves steeped in a kind of forgetting, but they also obscure the very ways in which black feminism acts or can act as a decolonial project. Dotson argues that the Combahee River Collective's naming of the term identity politics, and they are the people to name that term. That's the first time you see it in print, as far as I know, and I've looked. Right, so it's interesting that that term gets maligned now when there's a bunch of radical queer black feminist folk talking about how they were trying to fight for their own liberation and they understood it as rooted in identity politics. Isn't that interesting? So the Combahee River Collective's naming of the term identity politics allows identity to act as a form of political witness to the continuing logics of settler colonialism conceived in a settler, native, slave triad. But it is precisely the ways that black feminism brings us back again and again to these devastating histories, like settler, native, and slave, and the ways those histories are inscripted on black women's bodies that motivates the desire among both black and non-black feminists alike to move on from history. And I know it, I can feel it, because these sound like I'm rehearsing old feminist debates, right? About how white women don't get it right. We want to move on from that. Sharon Patricia Holland asks, does black femaleness carry the sign of history's reach upon us so completely that we must give her up in order to go about our theoretical business? If, as Wigman argues, intersectionality's, quote, figural resolution as a comprehensive, inclusive, multidimensional approach to the intersections of race and gender renders black women's experience paradigmatic, then what does feminist theory do with the perceived encroachment of the black female body? Because apparently black female bodies and black feminine performing bodies are still considered too material and too political and too particular to be theoretical. So Wiegman ultimately positions the black female body as, quote, a drag on theory. That's Linda Alcoff's term. Or more specifically, quote, a drag of the particular against the attempts of the mind to develop universalizable theory. But Marcano pushes back that, quote, the postmodern body, shattered by multiplicity, shape-shifting, and indeterminacy, also obscures the located, limited, inescapably partial, and always personally invested nature of human story-making. In other words, there is no escaping particularity. So why have I taken you through this somewhat dense theoretical argument? So what I'm really trying to get at is that there's a way that intersectionality gets reduced to an intervention, and then its conceptual limits become artificially prescribed. And it becomes ultimately a project that is endlessly concerned with getting just the right language to mark one's political commitment to inclusivity. So black feminist theorists are then put in the position where they are forced either to move on from intersectionality in order to prove that black feminism is capable of progressive thought and is not overly concerned with the lives of black women to the exclusion of all others, or we are forced to spend all our time defending the continuing import of intersectional perspectives, which makes us seem reactionary and supports a narrative of black feminists as stuck in the past, perpetually angry, and therefore impeding progress. So one of the clearest places that we can see this is in popular feminism on the interwebs. Every month or so, there's a huge rumble on black feminist Twitter, usually because a white woman has done something egregious. Something that makes clear that intersectionality, though it has been a term and concept for 26 years, has not actually penetrated popular consciousness. So most recently, Patty Arquette went to the Oscars and proclaimed that it was time for all the gay people and all the people of color to fight for all the women who have fought for them forever. I think some black women would beg to differ about whether white women have fought for them forever. Anyway. So I was deeply disgusted with Arquette because what type of foolishness is that? And I created this Twitter hashtag called Ask a White Feminist, right? In which I outsourced all the intellectual and emotional labor of explaining to others why all the women aren't white to conscious white feminist allies, right? And what I was saying was, look, so what happens is white women say things that are problematic. Twitter goes up, black feminist Twitter goes up, which means they turn up, they get mad, they show out real bad. It's great, I love it. And they drag folks, which is, you know, parlance for like you getting your ass handed to you. And people come to watch this because it's really magnificent. And then what happens is that people are following whatever hashtag it is, and inevitably you have good white people who will come and be like, but I don't understand because all women, wage inequality, we should care about all women. Why are you being so divisive? Which just sends black women into even more of a tizzy, right? Because it's like, how many times and how many people do we have to explain this to? So I declared myself in salon and on Twitter as on strike. And every time white women would come and ask me this question, I would be like, hashtag ask a white feminist. Sometimes I would tweet, white feminist, come get your girl, help her out, right? Because part of what I was trying to say is that there's a problem when black women and women of color are asked to do this continual, perpetual, emotional, and intellectual labor of teaching white feminists how to not be bad racist feminists, right? And everybody's so well-meaning, and so then they want you to be like really nice to them, but they saying shit that's egregious and offensive. And so you don't feel like being, you know, it's like the first girl that comes along, I'll be like, okay, let me help her out. This is my good deed for the day. And then there's like 15 girls. And by number two, I'm generally done. So then I show out real bad, right? And then we get the narrative that we're angry. And so then you get folks like Michelle Goldberg at The Nation last year writing a piece about how Twitter is just so dangerous and it's a jungle and white women are afraid to use it because, you know, they're afraid that black feminists are going to attack them. Like, this article really made these kinds of claims, right? So it's dainty you know, well-meaning white girls getting attacked by big, bad black girls. But that was a narrative in 2014, not 1984, right? So there have been many of these dust-ups, including, like, there was the dust-up over the Femme Future hashtag, which was a group of, largely driven by white women, but I was part of this group with some other women of color to think about internet feminism and create a funding structure so that a lot of the work that we do that's unpaid labor could be funded. Black feminists were very upset about that because they were like, some of those same white girls have stolen our work for years and gotten big book deals, and what are y'all doing? And then there was Mickey Kendall's hashtag Solidarity is for White Women, which had had millions of shares, went viral. Sui Park's Not Your Asian Sidekick. Fuck Cis People, which was a hashtag about cisgender privilege, and many more. But one of the things that concerned me about these episodic feuds on Twitter is that in some ways, while they make needed space to name and demand accountability for the continuing racist acts done by white women to black women and women of color, they also place black women and black feminism in a reactionary position, so that it becomes easy to reduce the theoretical contributions of black feminism to questions of intersectionality, and more specifically to questions of identity and identity politics. Now, as I said, I don't have a problem with identity politics because I understand that as part of my own black feminist intellectual inheritance. But there are two problems with current black feminist postures in social media. One, again, is that intersectionality is not meant as an account of identity. So no, just because I know your race, class, gender, and like sexual orientation or something, I still don't know very much about you, right? I don't actually, like, I am black middle class woman. Straight for now, right? Like, you know? So what, you don't know anything about me because you know that, right? You don't know who Brittney Cooper is. You know categories that Brittney Cooper occupies, right? That's a difference. So when intersectionality asks us to name our social location and structural position, it is meant as a way to name structural and institutional forms of jeopardy. What those categories do tell you is some of the places where I might be dealing with jeopardy that might need to be ameliorated, or places where I might become institutionally invisible, right? So it's an account of structural power, not an account of identity, right? The second problem is that in the era of post-structuralism, we primarily think of identities as discourses, as issues of language. And what this marrying of the two means is that when Kimberly Crenshaw was initially talking about intersectionality, she was talking about racism and sexism and classism. And now we talk about race, class, and gender. See how those are not the same terms? They're not the same terms. One names, this set of terms names systems of oppression. This set of terms names identity categories. Right? So she was telling us how systems of oppression might impact structural identity categories, but she wasn't arguing that knowing your race, class, and gender means I know everything about you. Right? So now young feminists are deeply concerned with making sure every positionality is named in an endless acronymic procession. Whether we're talking about, so look at the acronym, LGBTQIAQ, like it just goes on and on and on. Now I want to be clear that I'm not mocking the acronym, right? The work of language is incredibly important, and I think the questions about inclusivity are vital, right? We can't get past them. But I am starting to wonder whether our insistence on naming all of these identity categories does the actual institutional and political work of inclusivity that our declarations seem to suggest they do, right? So it's like a whole bunch of people running around talking about, like, look, the way that white folks, white feminists in the academy deploy intersection, I'm talking about good white liberals, right? They employ, they deploy intersectionality as a pronoun to say, see, I'm one of the good white people. I get it. I do race, class, and gender. But that doesn't have anything to do with their inclusivity practices necessarily. There are plenty of white feminists out here deploying that language, and they still trifling human beings in terms of their feminist interactions with people. And I'm talking about the stories of real women of color in the academy who talk about folks who deploy this language, but their politic is really jacked up, right? So you have folks like Weekman, who I don't know personally, who I imagine wants to have good politics, but is really saying all of these limits of intersectionality, really got to think about the limit. When you start evacuating the sort of intellectual basis for this, that has real political implications for actual people, right? So rather than working to make the challenges with intersectionality more theoretically tenable, which assumes that like all theory, it can grow and change and morph and be reshaped, instead, it is that its limitations or perceived proscribed limitations become reason to then move on from it. But ain't nobody trying to move on from Deleuze and Guattari's assemblages, and ain't anybody trying to move on from any of Foucault's various formulations that have myriad limitations. With white male theorists, people build careers off of finding the limitations and expanding the frameworks. With our folks, they say, see, this limitations means I can't talk about myself like I want to, so y'all in the past and we moving forward. And I'm here to call bullshit on that. So, look, this thing I'm saying about the proliferation of identity categories, right? I'm reminded of an admonition by one of the major activists in Ferguson, a friend of mine, Reverend Osayefu Seku. Now, he has argued that, quote, the radical black feminist and womanist tradition sheds light on the racist and sexist formulations inside and outside the black community and keeps its eye on systems writ large. However, the neoliberal disposition directs its fever-pitched critique at the blatant racist and sexist actions of individuals. Again, the dominant intellectual disposition of contemporary black intellectuals is neoliberal. Their anti-racist, anti-sexist, anti-transphobic, and anti-homophobic sentiments are easily incorporated into the neoliberal project without critiquing neoliberalism. Now look, I don't fully agree with his wholesale denouncement of black intellectuals, and in a piece that I wrote at CFC called Bell, Beyonce, and Bullshit, I thoroughly take him to task for the problems with this piece. But where we agree is that this point he raises about the co-optation of anti-racist, anti-sexist, anti-transphobic, and anti-homophobic discourse in a neoliberal project of inclusion and diversity is alarmingly accurate. So what he's saying is folks can take the language that we have and be like, no, because we trans inclusive, right? We're sensitive to the operations of race, class, gender, and sexual identities, but never ever want to transform the structure. Right, that becomes fundamentally violent. So if intersectionality is reduced to a discussion of the way to talk about identity, then that would constitute a gross misuse and misdirection of Crenshaw's term, right? Which is ultimately always trying to point us to structural oppressions on actual bodies and life chances. So this means that black feminism's ethical commitment to world making has been outpaced by an ethical focus on inclusionary language and discourse. And this has placed us in a reactionary and co-optable position, both in the academy and outside of it. And here are the ways that that has happened. First, it has made black feminists the moral police of feminism, right? So what happens on Twitter is, and this is the thing I learned at the Crunk Feminist Collective, because in like 2010, 2011, we were just getting started, and white women would do things and we would be like, this is bullshit, and we would call it out, write these great pieces. And we learned that we would get a lot of clicks if we spent our time calling out white women for racism. We would get a lot of clicks, we would get a lot of angry white women in the comments just proving our point was great. And you could even get a little bit of money, because it turns out that white women will pay you to come tell them that they are not about that life, like. And I'm not actually saying that with any joy. I find it funny, but it's also kind of disturbing, right? Because here's what I mean. So they will give us money and clicks to perform this and embody this kind of righteously indignant compass, moral compass of a movement whose ethical priorities, so we're the constant, right, in a movement whose ethical priorities are shifting just because of generational changes. And so if what black feminists do in feminism is spend our time calling out racism, it becomes easy to position us as a constant in a movement that is growing and changing. We become home, we become mother, we become ethical center and God, all of which we like to think of as unchanging, nurturing, and lovingly scolding. This is a problem. In academic terms, it is a natural outgrowth of black feminism getting into bed with post-structuralism, a liaison we couldn't resist because we needed it in order to gain and retain academic legitimacy, the academic legitimacy of being sufficiently theoretical, which is to say that Barbara Christian lost the debate, and it was a debate, and she lost it. But what it also means now is that we're caught in an endless web of deconstruction, particularly the discursive deconstruction of identity. And what I'm saying to you is, look, like, as long as white women do problematic things, or any people do problematic things, I think they deserve to be called out. But I'm interested in how black feminism can return to its own ethically driven project of world making, and what black feminist theorists have called for two decades visionary pragmatism, all of which is a decidedly constructivist project, right? And so I'm not advocating for an abdication of the kind of language policing that goes on. I am advocating for a realignment of priorities. And I'll give you a concrete example. After we recognized this at the CFC, we were like, we didn't get into this to write about how white women don't always get it right. We got into this to write about ourselves and to write about things that matter to us as a particular community of folks trying to live out our feminist politics. We wanted to build the world we wanted to see, so we made a clear shift at CFC to highlighting the work of people who were doing the kind of work that we think matters, and we also made a commitment to talking about issues that matter to us as a women of color collective in terms of how we live our feminist lives. So certainly, words matter, right? Blogging has taught us that it creates new worlds, and I think that that's why we continue to be focused on discourse to the exclusion of materiality, which is a problem. But whenever we hear a bus full of white college kids singing the N-word gleefully in celebration of their fraternity, we are reminded of just how much words matter. When we are a member of a marginalized identity category forced to navigate a world in which we are always assumed not to exist, words matter. When we have been unfairly arrested by the police and are begging for our lives, only hear to the police say, fuck your breath, as we die, words matter. But in the early era of academic black feminism, words and language mattered in a different way. In that earlier era, Christian cautioned us that we would lose something critical if we went along with the push towards critique and theory. Namely, we would become less able rather than more able to talk about experience and to talk about how to make different kinds of worlds. We are deeply, deeply invested in our right to critique in the academy, but there are limits. And so I would hope that when we begin again, that as we begin again to revisit what we lose in critique and what we lose in language policing, that we would engage in a different kind of ethic. One of those ethics is to do as my friend Dr. Treva Lindsay says and engage with an ethic of critical generosity, which is part of the reason that we don't spend all our time fighting with white women, right? It's a distraction. But also, with an ethic of love, and I'm helped in this by Dotson, by Christy Dotson, who is deeply influential to my own thinking. And she argues that to do black feminist philosophy, and I would argue black feminist theory more generally, is an act of radical love that presupposes trust and value in the theorizing of black people. So she writes, to produce black philosophy and theory then is hard work. In anti-black context, it is daring work. It is work that requires a commitment to and trust in black people in general and black women in particular, along with the daring to produce in accordance with this commitment and trust. A commitment to black people, an unassailable trust in black people, and the daring it takes to produce black philosophy in anti-black intellectual context is a manifestation of radical love. And her turn to productivity, right, and the work of building and world making is the reason I'm inspired by this thinking. And to put it the way that we put it at CFC, what you build is infinitely, infinitely more important than what you tear down. Thank you.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure Christy Dodson mentioned you in her talk, which is kind of cool. So obviously you influence her work as well. I'm not sure I have a question yet, but I'm just linking it to what she talked about, which was epistemic oppression and sort of another way of thinking about reasons to not engage in like kind of pointless conversation sometimes. and also you speaking about how it automatically puts us in a reactionary position reminds me of what she said about like the way that epistemes, is that the word? Mm-hmm. The way that they work makes it so that if you're a black woman who's about justice, you automatically lose, like, and end up having to argue points that are just fictions, and then you can't really beat. She talked specifically about perfect victimhood, and so I guess I don't know if I have a question. I just kind of appreciate that because I get tired of talking of schooling people, and I think. And you know, we get tired, right? And it inhibits collective work and collective taking care of each other on this campus. I guess if you have, I don't know, any more thoughts, reactions to like just how it messes with collective work.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. I think. In some ways, I mean, thank you for those connections. I like Christy's work on episode. I like all her work. One of the things I realized, because I also do this writing in Salon and I get lots of hate mail and death threats and terrible things, is like stress is, it will kill you, right? And that continual assault of other people's words actually has a traumatic impact. It is not just, it doesn't just exist in the realm of the discursive. So when I was telling black women, go on strike, do not do this with white women this time. Like, what do we have white feminist allies for if you can't call on them and be like, get your people, get them and help them out. And so part of it is about recognizing that that labor means that there's other labor that we need to be doing that we're not doing, or that we are just doing labor that doesn't need to be done, period, right? Because it's, that is not for us to do. So I don't even want to say that it's we stop doing that labor so we can do other forms of labor. I think we stop doing that labor so we can take care of ourselves, right? So that we can be well. But I think this other point that you raise about how, if we care about justice, then we always lose. Part of that is about the fact that justice work is considered the realm of politics, right? It's not considered theory, right? Because it's so particular and it's rooted in bodies. And so part of what I think, so one, Christy has helped me to think about how we shouldn't concede that theory matters more than politics, even in academic spaces where folks say that that's the currency. But since I have a job and I have to get tenure, then sometimes I have to play theory. And so, part of what I'm also trying to argue is why isn't this seen as black women's theoretical contribution, right? The indefatigability of the body, right? That no matter how much you run around, that you can't escape, but you always have to encounter the materiality of the body, right? That there is no such thing as disembodied theoretical practice. I mean, other feminist scholars, white feminists too, have been saying this. Black feminists aren't the only ones to say it, but we're the best folks saying it. Right? Because we're the ones that don't have any possibility of the escape route of the body. Because when we encounter institutional violence, it shows up in the body. Right? So it shows up in the procession of earth. Barbara Christian died at like age 59. It shows up in a procession of sisters like her who died like around 59 or 60. So really, part of the reason that we started the Crump Feminist Collective is because we were like, we can't let this shit kill us. And we only know that it does, we know that for whatever reason, we can have professor jobs with good benefits and great salaries and no economic precarity, and still these supposedly great institutions somehow have the kind of violent material impact on black women's bodies that they just check out her. So we know that it's not just words, right? And so for me, so rather than that being looked at as an indictment of how unrigorous black feminism is, I see it as one of our primary intellectual contributions. What do you do with the body? Right, and this is why I get mad when stuff like this happens. So now, everybody's talking about affect theory, which is all about the body. How do we experience emotions and affect and sensation and, you know, and look, I love affect theories. I think they're great. I cite them, I read them, but I laugh when I do it. Because I'm like, now, black feminism has been talking about forever how we feel about shit, how we think. You know, so affect theory, so, you know, talking about, like, affective energy between people. Just go to any black fluffy space and that's all folk are talking about. We've been talking about that, right? That's what Christian is talking about when she says, I read this and I feel shit. So now affect theorists want to how do we understand how you feel with the right, they want to talk about new sociologies rooted in affect. And I'm going, well, I'm reading Fanny Barrier Williams in 1897, and she has the term sociality in the text in 1897, because she's talking about, how do I love a bunch of black women? She was rich, and she was like, how do I love these working class black women? Because our lives are tied together, even though I don't like them very much. Now, her politics are jacked up. But her theoretical contribution isn't, because she's saying, one, I don't feel race unity as an essentialist thing. And two, she's saying, there's an affective investment I have in folks looking like me being well. But do black folks get credit for being in the genealogy of affect theorists in the 19th century? Nah. Because people don't respect us as theoreticians, because she's also asking a question that's fundamentally political at the same time, right? So that's part of the reason that I do the work, because really, and Christy got me out here fighting. Like she's like, look, you know, so this is the last point, and it reminded me of this. When you are like, we fight these fights, we can't win, well, Christy taught me this great thing. I used to be a competitive debater, and it was a debate tactic, and then she said to me, she said, look, so I would be saying, don't ever let anybody put you on the defensive. You can't win debates on the defensive, right? So it's time to stop ceding this ground. So we don't have to keep proving to white folks why they should listen, right? Or why we're being violent and why our being angry makes us violent. They have to prove why they're not being angry about shit doesn't make them violent, right? They have to prove, we don't have to prove why we need to stay on intersectionality. They have to prove why it's philosophically tenable to go past intersectionality in this move, right? Make them prove the legitimacy of the move, right? Not our desire to stay, right? Make them show why that's not a fundamentally violent act to be like, well, we just tired of talking about y'all now, and we interested in some new accounts of identity, because why does intersectionality can exist with all kinds of accounts of identity? Right? It's not impeding them. It actually makes, so what intersectionality did was lift the veil and say, oh shit, there's other people who identify differently. It like actually made those people visible. Now you have to talk about how they identify and what does that mean. But you can't do that without intersectionality, because it's the one that said, oh, there are other people that exist that you can't see behind the veil. Du Bois, right? Intersectionality lifts the veil. That's what it does. In a good part, if we really grapple with shit, yanks that shit down and burns it. Right? But that's what it does. But part of this is about actually believing black folks are theorists who care about how the world works, and believing the intellectual integrity of what we do. And when you believe in that, see, then the other thing that happens is I don't have time to beef with folks on Twitter, because I'm trying to figure out how black feminists theorize freedom. Right? I'm trying to figure out what a black feminist conception of justice actually is. Right?
Because those are theoretical questions that for all this work we have yet to answer, at least implicitly we might be saying, but explicitly we haven't necessarily said it. So I don't have time, like, and then part of the reason that we don't know where to go with these debates is because we get into them and we know an injustice has been done, but we don't fundamentally know how to articulate what the justice we seek looks like. Because that's the work that theoreticians do. Right? Yeah. Yes.
I'm going to try to keep this brief, but first, thank you for a remarkable genealogy of Black feminism and Black feminist theory, and a really exciting direction on the future of Black feminist theory, right? So I have what I think is a simple question, right? If what you're arguing is that we need to, our Black feminist futures have to return to questions of structure and materiality, right? What is the place of Black Marxism in that?
Mm-hmm. So this is interesting, right? Because I think that, I think that if you look at the early folks, they're reading, like, Fran Beal, she's giving lectures on Marxism. I've looked at them, right, in the archive. So I think that those early moments are rooted in a sort of a Marxist account of class, right? So I think that we have to go back and retain that. What has happened instead, though, is, because the other part, like, I gave y'all a part of a paper that I'm getting ready to publish. So one of the things that's happened is that the Marxism conversation, the historical materialism conversation, has been outsourced to queer of color critique. Right, so Rod Ferguson says that queer of color critique is women of color feminisms plus historical materialism plus an account of state formation, right, plus an account of queer theory. And I'm like, well, that assumes that there's not an account of historical materialism within Black feminism. So I think we need to go back and reclaim the account. I think it has total relevance. So for me, I'm just like, well, let's look back at what folks are saying in the 70s and 80s. So in the second book, that I'm very slowly starting, one of the things I do in that book is go back to the 70s and basically argue, it's a hip-hop feminism book, but it argues that hip-hop, Black feminism, and neoliberalism all come about at the same time. Contemporary Black feminism, not 19th century version. And so what happens if we look at Black feminism in the 1970s as intuiting, but by virtue of folks' material condition, the neoliberal shift, and responding already, because it's sort of on the forefront of the class critique that becomes relevant now, particularly if you're looking at Combahee, but also Fran Beal. I mean, and you look earlier, I mean, we should bring back somebody like Claudia Jones, I think.
That's what I was thinking about. My work is in Latin American and Caribbean. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking about the Black women who are writing and theorizing, doing something like the Grenada Revolution, or Black women's activism in Brazil, and thinking about kind of hemispheric
Interesting.
Black feminist future, and particularly the ways in which I would argue Black women, perhaps in Latin America and the Caribbean, began a critique of neoliberalism earlier than maybe anywhere else, right?
Yeah.
Because of IMF agreements in Latin America and the Caribbean, right? That language of neoliberalism was popularized well before in the U.S.
Love it and need it. So write it, and if you have it, and then let me cite it. Yeah, love that. I'm with you all the way. I mean, look, I think I appreciate that you understood that I was doing this genealogy, because for me, so much of this is about saying to folks, like, it's a rich theoretical tradition, right? And folks, so I pose a lot of questions that I don't have answers to, because it's a body of work. I mean, that's a huge body of work, right? And I'm just saying, like, when folks look at our stuff and they say, well, we've said everything we need to say, and it's like, well, talking about controlling images on television is like not even the only thing Collins said, right? And so, yeah, I'm just saying, let's look back and like actually take the questions up and see where they go. And so one of the places that I'm really excited, you know, that new book, Towards an Intellectual History of Black Women, just came out. So I think it's also gonna, I'm hoping that in a very odd twist of things, the history reinvigorates theory, yeah. Yes.
Thank you so much for. Okay. Thank you so much. This was really helpful to me. The crash course in Black feminist history, especially. I come from a
film and literature background. So this was very helpful. Mm-hmm. What I couldn't help feeling was that I felt the scope of the problem expanding. when you start talking about intersectionality and about wanting to reduce it from systems of power to identity, or wanting to reduce how the problem affects the body to a theoretical framework, it almost sounds like wishful thinking, that, you know, that we hope that the problem is smaller than what Black feminism is telling us the problem is. Is that in any sense that you get, or am I totally off the mark?
Yeah, no, I mean, look, I think the problem with a structural account is that it takes away all your optimism. Really, I mean, you know, it fucks with liberal optimism, right? Because liberals believe that if we can just figure out a specific set of problems, then we can solve those problems, right? And you start delving into the sort of deepness of this thing, and it requires a couple things. One, it requires a sort of relentless structural critique, which, you know, and look, and I mean, I am post-structuralist in ways. Like, I'm moved by agency, right? You will hear me in other versions, other talks, talk a lot about agency. I don't always know how we balance the two, like, but I believe in it. I'm here for it. Right? But one, you have to have this sort of relentless structural critique, and two, it also means, I think that it's like white folks having to continually re-encounter themselves, not unlike straight people, right? Having to continually re-encounter themselves and realize that, like, fundamentally, like, your impulse is actually always to do the wrong thing first, not the right thing, right? So you have to, critique. So if we're doing theoretical work in the academy, you, like, Barbara Tomlinson helps me, because she's like, look, you know, these folks assume that their job is to critique intersectionality rather than make intersectionality a viable concept that can keep on moving and stay in the conversation, right? But it's interesting, because that is not these folks' orientation to white men. So you can look at the body of work of white men and be like, listen, here's all the shit it misses. So what I'm gonna do is write books showing how, if they would just include me, it would be fine. And that's like a lot of white feminist theorizing, that's what it is. Whereas with us, it's just like, look at all this stuff. And look, what bothers me about intersectionality is that in some way, I mean, I really feel like on the very basic level, folks are just like, we're tired of talking about Black women. We're tired of talking about y'all. We wanna go back to the lovely days when we could talk about ourselves, we could about women as a category, right? And if you won't let us do that, then we just want to talk about gender. We don't, why are y'all still tethered to women? And we're like, because we just getting to be women, right? Black women are just getting to be women. Like, we spent a good part of the 20th century still, not, it wasn't just a 19th century project for Black women to get to argue that they were actually women. So it's interesting that now that we're like, okay, so we women now. Not ladies still, but I'm not really into that. that now folks are like, well, we want to talk about gender. Because that's another thing Wigman's doing in this book, is talking about, like, the move from women to gender, right? And then gender to trans. Now, she's skeptical about it. She says, asks a similar question, does it do the work of political inclusivity that we think that it does? But yeah, so I just think it's like, it means that folks have to keep on encountering themselves and recognizing the level of emotional vigilance it takes to be really an ally in any system, right? And I think that that's incredibly hard to do. The other thing that's happening is, look, now that social media has occurred, it has leveled the playing field. So now white women can't stumble and bumble through this. They do that and their whole lives get dragged on Twitter. And again, while that is fun to watch, it's not necessarily nice. And we don't have any moral integrity to the claim that Black women and women of color should be nice, though. Right? So that becomes the problem. And look, I've had dust up with some of these Black feminists, Twitter feminists. I get, like, thrown in with them, but we fight. We scrap, too. Right? Because, I don't think I have too many respectability pearls left. But sometimes, when they turn up real bad, I'm like, how is this productive? Right? Then I'll be like, shit, you're tone policing your own people. Right? It's really hard, right? Because the academician in me and the former competitive debater in me believes in like reasoned discourse. Like I actually believe that. That's why I write papers with like finely, you know, situated arguments, or I try for them to be finely situated, right? But these, a lot of these chicks are just like, this is a street fight, and we mad, and we own this, we run it, and they have come into our neighborhood, and so here's what you get. And so then I'm saying to them, well, then when they call this a jungle in the magazine, and you acting like it's a street fight, then what we do? Which is to say, there are many contradictions here. It's like I say to white allies that I like. I will own that there are like contradictions, because black folks will, like justice people, right, will be like, white allies, we need you to, you know, shut up, right? Stop owning the sinner. Just sit down and shut up. Then when white people come to things and injustice is happening and they don't say shit, then it's like, why didn't you speak up, white people? Speak up. We need you to speak up. And then when you speak up, it's like, why? This is not about you. Like, it just, you know? I recognize the contradictions of that shit, because I can't stand contradictory arguments, right? I don't like bad arguments. I want us to be argumentatively tight. And so I recognize that we be running white people around, and part of it is just fun. It's just like, yay! Right? Good white people are trying to accommodate us. Let's have fun. Right? I'm serious. Like, some of this is just human shit. It is. You know, so in private, I'll be like saying to black people, like, really though? But publicly, I have to stand with those black people. I just be like, this is a shame. This is a shame. These are my people. Because the other thing is, because at the end of the day, while I might think that this is like a little bit fucked up, I think like, we can't really trust y'all though, right? Real talk. So yeah, it's a lot of negotiation, which is why we gotta have some ethics around how we do things, like some real ethics of engaging with folks, like assuming people's humanity, assuming good intention. But I'm talking about white folks, right? Because white people always want black people to assume their humanity and good intentions. They don't assume ours. Because when you assume humanity and good intention, you make space for people being really upset. I said this to a group the other day. One of the things that's missing sometimes in this conversation, when folks are like, why are black people so mad? I'm like, because that level of rage is hurt feeling. Like racism and sexism and homophobia, those things hurt. Like they hurt. They hurt our feelings. Yes, we are mad and righteously indignant, but that's a power position. But the vulnerable position is that hurts my feelings, right? And we actually have an empathy gap in this country, like a well-documented empathy gap, where white people don't actually believe that black people feel as much pain as they feel. Like that's been well proven. So you go to the hospital, you know, you're like, my pain's at an 8, but when the white person's looking at you, they think your pain's at a 3. Right? Or you say that you're in distress. Like my good friend Melanie Price, who I teach with at Rutgers, was just telling me in social psychology research, like, that, you know, in these tests that they did where, you know, where you could hear over an intercom that, like, folks that sounded white versus folks that sounded black were in distress in a room where some things were going to crash out of the ceiling, that, like, folks were quicker to run to the white people when the things crashed than the black people. Like, same scenario, just different racial markers. And they just, so distress, pain, all of those things are, you know, white folks are less responsive to distress and pain than black people. So it makes a little sense when you think about those videos we've seen of folks getting killed, why cops believe in excessive force. I mean, there are many problems with policing, but one of them is when you're choking somebody, they don't actually, it's like they believe we're superhuman, right? So they, or and subhuman at the same time. So they don't actually believe that we can, that we're feeling a lot of pain. So when we then say, like, we're so upset, it's an accumulation of pain. And as soon as white folks just get that, like, I'm talking to people who are in pain because of shit that I did or people who look like me did, right? You will automatically see a different response. But part of it is that folks don't hear pain, they hear anger and rage, and we think anger and rage is illegitimate, but it's not illegitimate if injustice is being done and you're continually being subjected to pain. You know?
So, as a proudly embodied dread on theory, otherwise known as a social historian, I would like to bring you back to some people you're writing about.
Okay.
And as when I heard you present at the Berkshire Conference, you were talking a little bit about Paula Murray,
yeah.
One of my eternal favorite characters, trans, black feminist theorist, credible legal theorist, right? Who's wrote what Thurgood Marshall says, the Bible of the civil rights movement in terms of legal theory, but who also hitchhiked across the South in the 1930s dressed as a man with her white girlfriend.
That's right. She's great.
And I kind of want to know how that remarkable character and your presentation of her fits in with this theoretical frame that you laid out today.
In a couple of ways. One is, so it's important to put Pauli Murray in the genealogy of trans theory and trans history. So, and she's interesting because what I like about Pauli Murray is she tries to work out her trans identity in three ways. First, she tries to work it out scientifically. That doesn't work. Then she tries to work it out in terms of her politics, right? So becoming a feminist, fighting for women's rights, fighting for gender equality. But by the end of her life, she tries to work it out in terms of religious identity. I'm accepted, right, by God. So she goes for the three sacred, science, law, religion, as a way to think about gender identity and how to embody that. So I find that very interesting. The other thing that's interesting to me about her, see, when I was writing about Pauli Murray and I was writing about the early part of her life, so in the 30s and 40s when she's struggling with trans identity but doesn't have the language, then how do you write about a figure like that? Because Foucault says that we can't name things until we have the language for them, right? But she's actually embodying a trans identity before we have the language for trans identity. So what does that then mean, right? Is her body a drag on theory? In a certain sort of way. And so I don't always resolve that. I mean, I decided just to try to be a good historian, which I dabble in a little bit, and say, I'm not going to call her trans, but I'm going to think about her as a person who maps for us what trans identities look like in a moment before there's language and in a moment before there's even science, because she's searching hard for the science too. Like, there's all these news clippings in her archives of her researching experimental hormones. Mm-hmm. And she spent her summers at school. When she would be off in the summers at Howard, she would travel to New York and meet with doctors there to see if they would experiment on her with hormones. She begged to be experimented on. This was in the late 30s and early 40s. So she's literally just about 10 to 15 years ahead of her time, because by 1950, John Money is thinking about intersex and trans identity and beginning to name that. But by then, she's a big civil rights attorney. So she makes a negotiation. So I'm also using her work, her life and archive, as a way to think about how to reinvigorate black feminist theory. So one of the things that I do say about Murray, I don't pursue this as much in the book as I did in the dissertation, is I think that her fluidity is one of the places that proves that we do need another account of identity beside intersectionality, right? Because intersectionality is thinking about fixed structural identities, right? Race, gender, class. But what happens if you're moving all along those axes, right? She's class mobile, her gender identity shifts drastically, and she's not too fond of being called black.
Yeah, it's true, she's racially mobile too.
Yeah, she is very much like, I'm a Negro, and everybody, and Patricia Hill Collins, who is one of her students, is like, what? There's a great line, in Pauli Murray's autobiography, where Patricia Hill Collins is her student in college in 1969, and the students at Brandeis take over the campus. And so, so Pauli Murray writes this autobiography the year Patricia Hill Collins gets her PhD. So it's before she becomes this famous person. And she's like, there was this lovely top student in my class, and, the students were taking over the campus. And Pauli Murray was of old school. She was radical in her day, but became increasingly conservative. And so, the kids are in there tallying how much she uses Negro when they want her to use black and stuff like that. So she really is not with them. And she said, this lovely student named Patricia Hill gets up and walks out of my class one day and yells, black solidarity, and rolls out, right? which I love this story. I love it. Because, it's this great history of of also black feminists. It's like a black feminist genealogy story, right? About how does Priscilla Collins get to be the person that she is in this encounter with Pauli Murray? So you'll note that Collins comes through patriarchy, like where most feminist accounts of begin with patriarchy and then say other hierarchies are structured that way. You read Collins, particularly in Black Sexual Politics, and she says it's racism first and then patriarchy and these other hierarchies get structured through it. But I read that as an interesting debate in black feminism, right? Because Pauli Murray is very different, right? She really is like, no, patriarchy is a problem, and I experience gender oppression.
She coined the term Jane Crow.
That's right. That's right. So there isn't even a simple account of which structuring system is primary. You read some black feminists, and they will say patriarchy is primary, right? And they will use patriarchy as a way to get us to think about race, right? You read Collins, and she uses racism as a way to get us to think about patriarchy. But that, see how that's a debate that we should actually talk about? That we don't actually see in the text, but it's a tension, right? Because then that's also some of the battles around like who gets included in black feminism. So like when folks are like, well, was Ida B. Wells a feminist? And there's actually a little bit of debate about that. And it's like, well, she is if she's if Collins is an Ida B. Wells feminist, because Wells is rooted in the critique of lynching and state violence first, right? And then she comes to her critique of sexism. Where Murray comes to her critique of sexism because she watches black men keep her from talking in law school and exclude her from things. And she's like, well, this system is as bad as Jim Crow. But that's a different kind of account of the structure, right? So, yeah. So just trying to take them seriously as thinkers they're all black feminists, but they don't account for things in the same way. And in white feminist theory, like, we would actually know who thinks about the structure this way, who thinks about it that way. In black feminist theory, we're just like, nah, all of them said race and gender matter. Yes.
That was really, really energetic talk. And what I'm hearing is a way in which you are proposing digging in with your identitarian and theoretical skills of intersectionality vis-a-vis black feminist practice. Mm-hmm. And there are two things which I note about your talk, mm-hmm. which I'd like to hear a little bit more about.
Okay.
One has to do with the way in which the identitarian piece seems quite overdetermined around white feminism, mm-hmm. white feminist practice. Mm-hmm. And I was curious to know what are your thoughts about some of the recent movements around transcolonial and women of color kind of mm-hmm. coalitional practice mm-hmm. that shifts the terms from that epistemic work that has to do with black white
right.
feminist
right. Right.
worldviews.
Right.
And second thing that is kind of interesting to me is the way that you talk about subject formation mm-hmm. Intersectional matrix. And it gets me thinking about how it seems very resonant of post-positivist realism that's kind of like formulated by the group. Futures of Minority Studies Group, Sacramento, Moya, Michael, Garcia, which they try to reclaim some substance around
yeah.
subject formation that's been evacuated by post-structural discourse.
Yeah, yeah, so it's the materialist feminist, materialist race folk. Yeah, that's new materialist, right?
Right. So
yeah.
If you're thinking about that group, and I was wondering about, do you have that group in mind when you're
mm-hmm.
talking about these, not so much the reclamation, but really digging in the heels kind of moves that you're making?
Yeah, I am being more and more influenced by new materialists. I'm reading them a little bit more. So, yes, I'm thinking about them. And one of the reasons I'm thinking about them is because, I've been really interested in these, like, so I know, like, that the problems with biological race stuff. But I've been really interested and thinking about the new stuff in social epigenetics about how prolonged exposure to trauma changes the expression of genes, right? So that even if race is not biologically rooted, bodies become raced because of environmental conditions, right? So blackness or the race of blackness doesn't have any DNA root, but if you continue to subject people to structural trauma, right, then even if the racing is not phenotypic, it turns out that a whole group of folks that look similar in some ways will have markers of all kinds of things that make them die early, right? So I'm just interested in that material account because I think that that's politically one of the things we're dealing with. And so we got to be able to account for it theoretically without reinscribing essentialist and really like biologically determinist ideas about race. But to your first question, so I talked about white feminists here. It's a challenge because one of the biggest critics of intersectionality right now is Jasbir Poir. She's my Rutgers colleague. I don't have tenure. So I'm being strategic. I do have a piece coming out where I critique pretty hard in the Oxford Handbook of Feminist Theory. I write about intersectionality and I take on her work in terrorist assemblages. Yep. I just think she's wrong. I think the line in the talk where I say, or other women of color accuse us of being violent, I'm the footnote is for Poir, I'd rather be a cyborg than a goddess, where she basically says that intersectionality is itself co-opted by neoliberal state formations and colludes in those kind of identity categories. And I'm like, to me that feels disingenuous because to say that the thing that expose how those categories, like census categories and categories of protected classes within the law make people invisible, to then say that you're colluding with the categories because you have to name the categories to identify a structural problem, which is essentially the argument, right? That in naming the categories, you reify their legitimacy, right? But how do you name a problem if you can't name the categories that are causing the problem? That doesn't mean that intersectionality is invested or that it has to be invested in the continuation of those categories, but it does have to be invested in continuing to name them insofar as they continue to structure how people live, right? The other thing is, I just co-edited a special issue of a journal, like I dibble and dabble in digital humanities, and so I co-edited a special issue of a journal called Ada, it's a journal on gender and new media, but it was on hacking the black-white binary, and I did it with one of my Asian American colleagues, Margaret Reeve from Berkeley. And so we were trying to work through the sort of like, you know, how the black-white binary is not a sufficient account of racial politics and racial identities in the US. And yet, I'm still on the fence. And I'm helped along in this, like, I know that it feels wrong to say, but it's not that I think it's a sufficient account, but the folks who want to, there's a way that people talk about getting beyond it that I don't think we can do, right? So I think it needs expanding. I think it needs complicating. But very often, the folks who want to get beyond it feel like they are the folks who are, just like the post-intersectionality people want to not talk about black women anymore, the post-binary people don't want to talk. It's like they don't want to talk about black folks anymore. Because the way that the arguments are frequently constructed is not this. They are constructed as this binary excludes us from talking about like Asian American identity or talking about Latino folk, but then black people become the folks that they pick on in the conversation. They don't pick on white supremacy, right? They pick on how blackness occupies a privileged category in relationship to whiteness, and that becomes the problem, right? So Christy has me thinking more about like indigenous folks thinking about settler colonial dynamics because they do a better job of putting these things together, right, in terms of that we're talking about indigenous people, then we're talking about like racialization of Asian labor, and then we're talking about and Latinos, right, in terms of like deportation and battles over land as territory also fit in that frame, and then thinking about enslavement. So I'm moving in some critical directions. And I recognize the problem, but then when I read Holland, a lot of this talk is indebted to Sharon Patricia Holland's book, The Erotic Life of Racism, and she was like, I actually want to resist the transnational push. I actually want to resist the push beyond. Because here's one of the things that, there's this great piece in Signs from a couple years ago where Kelly Coogan Gear tracked the scholarship on black feminisms and women of color feminisms in signs. From the time, black feminisms from the 80s to when women of color feminisms catches on and has all this currency. And what she notes is that there is a steep decline in black feminist articles as soon as the terms women of color feminisms and transnational feminisms take off in the theoretical work. Then Signs publishes way more in those categories and way less, where they had been publishing lots of black feminist articles in the early days of black feminism in the academy. And so she thinks, and because it's like the premier journal of feminist theory, she says, look, that marks a particular, potentially anyway, marks a potential kind of evacuation so that, you know, black feminism can then just be subsumed under women of color feminisms, right? Even though then nobody's actually talking about black women anymore, but they can claim that they're doing diversity feminisms because they're talking about women of color feminisms. And if that's happening in the premier journal, in the field, not that black feminism was never talked about, but it was, and then they found something sexier to talk about. Now look, I could fall victim to my own critique there too, which is that I'm then picking on women of color feminisms as opposed to black feminisms, right? As opposed to the white feminists who are doing this. But for me, those are tensions and questions because I think folks want us to move on in every iteration. And I'm like, but then if you look in the academy, like, I have grad students who are coming and telling me that they don't want to do black feminism anymore. I've got young black women who want to do feminism, want to do like, but, and even if they're not queer students, they want to do queer of color critique because they think it's better on these questions. But if you look at queer of color critique, it's because queer of color critique essentially took all of the mined black feminism and women of color feminisms for all the questions on materialism, queer identity, and state formation, separated those out as categories, added them together, and then said, we're gonna do all of that and call it something else, right? And so I literally have seen a shift in young black women coming and saying, this is not sexy, we don't wanna do intersectionality, all this kind of stuff. And that's part of my political impulse for fighting back, because it feels like it's rooted in a misinterpretation of the tradition. But I hear you. I'm like working through those other questions, though.
All right, I think that has to be the last question.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.